All right, let's head back to our interview with KAA Acting Managing Director Alex Gitari. Apologies for that technical hitch a bit earlier on. But MD, we were talking about the financial hit given the 5 months of this slowdown.
Thank you, Vicky, for having me, and thank you, Citizen, for airing this interview live from JKA. I'm very delighted to be with you today on a day when we launched international flights. We had a ceremony earlier this morning where we witnessed KQ Flight 100 to London takeoff, and that was quite something special. It's been 5 months, like you said, when we've had no flights. Of course, we started domestic flights 2 weeks ago, and that was also was something special. But today is extra special because, like you mentioned, the financial hit has been really hard. 80% of our business is from passenger services. When that is wiped out, any business would literally be brought down to its knees. But we thank God that we've been able to cope with that situation. Obviously, we've had to come up with very innovative ways of coping with that situation. Cargo business has not been badly off. It constitutes about 20% of our business. And because cargo was not banned for very good reasons, I think that one we can say it has been okay. So financially, we've been hard hit. The real impact will not be known because obviously even the recovery process is going to be slow. We think that it will take a while before we are back to where we were before COVID started.
When you talk about a while, have you put a timeline to that? When you're thinking about passengers feeling comfortable enough to travel, right now it's more of an emergency basis. But by the time people feel, okay, I can actually enter into a flight cabin and I'll be fine, when are you looking at that in terms of a timeline?
I haven't put a specific timeline to that because we all need to work towards boosting the confidence to bring back people to flying. It is not just airport authorities like Kenya Airports Authority that needs to do that. We also need the airlines to do that. We also need the government and particularly the Ministry of Health to help us in terms of the health protocols that, you know, are put in place that boost confidence. So we are sure that once the confidence levels return, the recovery process will certainly be steady, but putting a timeline to it at this point in time will be very, very difficult. There have been some projections done by international organizations like IATA, but by and large, those still remain uncertain for now. So I wouldn't want to give it a specific timeline, but we are very optimistic, particularly having seen how domestic operations took off and how the international operations took off today. We are optimistic that it will not be long before we get back to what it was flying before COVID.
And this is not the first time we faced a health scare, if you will. We had the Ebola outbreak out of West Africa. How much more vigilant does the KAA staff have to be now? What measures have been put in place? Of course, we've seen the social distancing, you have to wear your face mask and hygiene, but what more has been put in place?
We put in a lot more. And it's good you mentioned the Ebola crisis because, yes, we learned a lot from that crisis. So even in terms of our preparedness to deal with this COVID crisis, I could say that what we learned during the Ebola crisis has helped us do a lot more as we have done. So talking about the specific protocols that we put in place, I mean, it's so elaborate and there's so much that has been issued out there. What I would say is that the critical ones, sanitization. For example, at JKIA, we've invested in so much sanitization facilities. We've got over 300 automatic sanitization points because we don't want passengers to come into contact with the sanitization stations themselves. So we invested in automatic sanitization stations. We've also clearly marked our floors so as we can promote physical distancing. It's very important that our passengers, when they come to our facilities, they ensure that they are physically distanced from each other. And then the issue of thermal screening. We take temperatures of our passengers when they come to the airport, and not just once, at least twice before they board the aircraft. Then the issue of personal protective equipment. Use of face masks, that is a mandatory requirement. We've gone beyond that. We want to protect our own staff. We want to protect the airline staff and the airport users at large. You'd have seen when you came up here that our check-in counters, we've actually installed protective glass shields so that the airline staff feel protected. Our own staff, we are providing them with the PPEs so that they also feel protected. So there are so many measures that we put in place. What we like to advise the traveling public is let them know that this is not this is now a new normal that we are coping with. Obviously, some of the measures that we put in place require that they spend a little bit more time going through our airport formalities. They should therefore give themselves a little bit more time before checking in so that they don't run into timing problems before catching their flights.
You mentioned something, time. And, you know, for many airports that pride themselves in efficiency, moving volumes of passengers through the terminals, you've added another step to this whole chain because of COVID-19. How are you going to ensure that once a flight comes in, you're moving people through as efficiently as possible despite this new step?
The real solution to efficiency, despite loading all these other extra protocols, is technology. And that is the way we're going. We are investing massively in technology to improve our processes. For example, when it comes to check-in, we want to employ the e-passport, where passengers can literally just scan their passports and they are let through without having to go physically through immigration counters. E-visas is also a similar process. Again, when it comes to visitors coming into the country, they can apply for their visas online without having to come and queue and congest the area when they are applying for their visas physically. The other area that we are investing, again, in technology is ensuring that we have contactless processes, all right? For example, in our retail operations, we are encouraging our retailers, the duty-free operators, the Forex bureaus and all those other shops that we have, including the restaurants, when it comes to payments, can they accept cashless payment modes so that we avoid contact, which will obviously minimize the risk of COVID-19.
And before I let you go, you know, many said after 9/11, air travel changed forever. As you look to the future, what do you see the future of air travel looking like? Will this shift the way we travel in the air for good, in your view?
Well, one thing is certain, Vicky, that this is a new normal. So just like 9/11 changed the aviation industry for good, we think that this pandemic is going to change the aviation industry also in a certain way, but not necessarily in a bad way. When we think of all the measures that now everybody is aware about, sanitization, using face masks and all that, we think there will be a long-term benefit, not just for the aviation industry, but even for the general population in terms of hygiene awareness. So if you ask me what I think about the future of the aviation industry, I think it is going to recover, just like it did recover from 9/11. It will bounce from this challenging pandemic and will get back to performing strongly as it has always done.
Alex Gitari, thank you so much for your time and braving the elements here. It's quite chilly, we must say, but thank you for your insights.
Thank you.
On that note, let's